You are listening to Christian Audio's production of Reading Romans with John Stott, Volume 2, by John Stott, and with Dale and Sandy Larsen. This book is read by Derek Perkins. This audio recording was produced in 2016 by Christian Audio, which owns the copyright. No portion of this recording may be reproduced for any reason without prior written consent from Christian Audio. This edition originally published by InterVarsity Press as Reading Romans with John Stott, Volume 2, by John Stott with Dale and Sandy Larsen. Copyright 2016, John Stott's Literary Executors. Recorded and distributed by permission of InterVarsity Press, P.O. Box 1400, Downers Grove, Illinois, 60515, USA. www.ivpress.com. All rights reserved. Please visit christianaudio.com, facebook.com/christianaudio, or twitter.com/christianaudio to offer your impressions of this work and to explore additional titles. How to Read the Bible with John Stott. During John Stott's life, from 1921 to 2011, he was one of the world's master Bible teachers. Christians on every continent heard and read John Stott's exposition of Scripture, which was at once instructive and inspiring. With over 8 million copies of his over 50 books sold in dozens of languages, it is not surprising that Time magazine recognized him in 2005 as one of the 100 most influential people in the world, and Christianity Today called him evangelicalism's premier teacher and preacher. At the core of his ministry was the Bible and his beloved Bible Speaks Today series, which he originated as New Testament series editor. He himself contributed several volumes to the series, which have now been edited for this Reading the Bible with John Stott series. The purpose of this volume is to offer excerpts of Stott's The Message of Romans in brief readings, suitable for daily use. Though Stott was himself an able scholar, this series avoids technicalities and scholarly debates, with each reading emphasizing the substance, significance, and application of the text. Following each set of 6 readings is a discussion guide. This can be used by individuals to help them dig more deeply into the text. It can also be used by study groups meeting regularly. Individuals in the groups can go through the 6 readings between group meetings and then use the discussion guide to help the group understand and apply the scripture passage. Discussions are designed to last between 45 and 60 minutes. Guidelines for leaders at the end of this volume offer many helpful suggestions for having a successful meeting. If you are a group member, you can help everyone present in the following ways. 1. Read and pray through the readings before you meet. 2. Be willing to participate in the discussion. The leader won't be lecturing. Instead, all will be asked to discuss what they have learned. 3. Stick to the topic being discussed and focus on the particular passage of Scripture. Only rarely should you refer to other portions of the Bible or outside sources. This will allow everyone to participate on equal footing. 4. Listen attentively to what others have to say. Be careful not to talk too much, but encourage a balanced discussion among all participants. You may be surprised by what you can learn from others. Generally, questions do not have one right answer, but are intended to explore various dimensions of the text. 5. Expect God to teach you through the passage and through what others have to say. 6. Use the following guidelines and read them at the start of the first session. We will make the group a safe place by keeping confidential what is said in the group about personal matters. We will provide time for each person to talk who wants to. We will listen attentively to each other. We will talk about ourselves and our own situations, avoiding conversation about others. We will be cautious about giving advice to one another. John Stott had an immense impact on the church in the last half of the 20th century. With these volumes, readers today can continue to benefit from the riches of the Bible that Stott opened to millions. Introduction. Ever since I became a Christian, I have enjoyed a love-hate relationship with Romans because of its joyful, painful, personal challenges. It began soon after my conversion with my longing to experience that death to sin which Romans chapter 6 seemed to promise. I toyed for many years with the fantasy that Christians are supposed to be as insensitive to sin as a corpse is to external stimuli. My final deliverance from this illusion was sealed when I gave a series of talks on Romans chapters 5 through 8. Next, Paul's devastating exposure of universal human sin and guilt in Romans chapter 1 verse 18 through chapter 3 verse 20 rescued me from that superficial evangelism which is preoccupied only with people's felt needs. Then there was Romans chapter 12 and its demand for our wholehearted commitment in response to God's mercies, and Romans chapter 13, whose teaching about the use of force in the administration of justice made it impossible for me to remain a total pacifist. As for Romans chapter 8, although I have declaimed its final triumphant verses at innumerable funerals, I have never lost the thrill of them. Paul, although a man of his age who addressed his contemporaries, also speaks to all people of every age. I have not been surprised to observe how many contemporary issues Paul touches on in Romans. Enthusiasm for evangelism in general, and the propriety of Jewish evangelism in particular. Whether homosexual relationships are natural or unnatural. Whether we can still believe in such unfashionable concepts as God's wrath and propitiation. The historicity of Adam's fall and the origin of human death. The fundamental means to living a holy life. The place of law and of the Spirit in Christian discipleship. The distinction between assurance and presumption, the relation between divine sovereignty and human responsibility in salvation, the tension between ethnic identity and the solidarity of the body of Christ, relations between church and state, the respective duties of the individual citizen and the body politic, and how to handle differences of opinion within the Christian community. And this list is only a sample of the modern questions which, directly or indirectly, Romans raises and addresses. Paul probably wrote the letter to the Romans from Corinth during the 3 months he spent in Greece. Acts chapter 20 verse 2. He mentions three places which he intends to visit: Jerusalem, Rome, and Spain. Paul thought of Rome being situated between Jerusalem and Spain as a place of refreshment after he had been to Jerusalem, and a place of preparation en route for Spain. His visits to Jerusalem and Spain were of special significance to him because they expressed his two continuing commitments to the welfare of Israel, Jerusalem, and to the Gentile mission, Spain. We still have to ask why Paul should write to the church in Rome. It was partly to prepare them for his visit. More than that, because he had not visited Rome before, and because most of the church members there were not known to him, he saw the need to establish his apostolic credentials by giving a full account of his gospel. With regard to his own situation, he sent them a threefold request: to pray that his service in Jerusalem would be acceptable, to help him on his way to Spain, and to receive him during his stopover in Rome as the apostle to the Gentiles. Paul's purposes in writing to the Romans are traceable not only to his own situation, however. His letter also arose from the situation in which the Roman Christians found themselves. The church in Rome was a mixed community consisting of both Jews and Gentiles, with Gentiles in the majority, and there was considerable conflict between these groups. This conflict was primarily not ethnic, different races and cultures, but theological. Different convictions about the status of God's covenant and law, and so about salvation. This controversy may be heard rumbling through Romans, and Paul is seen from beginning to end as an authentic peacemaker, anxious to preserve both truth and peace without sacrificing either to the other. As a patriotic Jew who had been specially commissioned as apostle to the Gentiles, he was in a unique position to be an agent of reconciliation. He was determined to make a full and fresh statement of the apostolic gospel, which would not compromise any of its revealed truths, but would at the same time resolve the conflict between Jews and Gentiles over the covenant and the law, and so promote the unity of the church. In his ministry of reconciliation, Paul develops two paramount themes and interweaves them beautifully. The first is the justification of guilty sinners by God's grace alone in Christ alone, through faith alone, irrespective of either status or works. This is the most humbling and leveling of all Christian truths and experiences, and so is the fundamental basis of Christian unity. Paul's second theme is the consequent redefinition of the people of God, no longer according to descent, circumcision, or culture, but according to faith in Jesus, so that all believers are the true children of Abraham, regardless of their ethnic origin or religious practice. In writing on Romans, my first responsibility has been to seek a fresh encounter with the authentic Paul. My aim is to allow the apostle to say what he does say, and not force him to say what we might want him to say. At the beginning of his 4th-century exposition of Romans, Chrysostom spoke of how much he enjoyed hearing Paul's spiritual trumpet. My prayer is that we may hear it again in our day and may readily respond to its summons. John Stott. 1. Romans chapter 9. Understanding God's purposes. A threefold affirmation. Romans chapter 9, verses 1 through 5. I speak the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it through the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people, those of my own race, the people of Israel. Theirs is the adoption to sonship. Theirs the divine glory, the covenants, the receiving of the law, the temple worship, and the promises. Theirs are the patriarchs, and from them is traced the human ancestry of the Messiah, who is God over all, forever praised. Amen. Chapters 9, 10, and 11 each begin with an expression of Paul's profound concern for the people of Israel. Here Paul offers a strong threefold affirmation, intended to put his sincerity beyond question and to persuade his readers to believe him. First, I speak the truth in Christ. Paul is conscious of his relationship to Christ and of Christ's presence with him as he writes. Second, as a negative counterpart, I am not lying or even exaggerating. Third, my conscience confirms it through the Holy Spirit. Paul knows that the human conscience is fallible and culturally conditioned, but he claims that his is illumined by the Spirit of truth himself. What is this truth that Paul asserts with such force? It concerns his continuing love for his people Israel, who have rejected Christ. He goes on to call them my people, those of my own race. Membership in the Christian community does not cancel out natural ties of family and nationality. Paul boldly states that he could wish that for Israel's sake he himself were cursed, anathema, and cut off from Christ. Paul is not literally expressing this wish, since he has already stated his conviction that nothing could ever separate him from God's love in Christ. Romans chapter 8, verses 35 through 39. He means that he could entertain such a wish if it could possibly be granted. The apostle's anguish over unbelieving Israel is the more poignant because of its unique privileges. Some of these he has mentioned earlier. Now he gives a fuller inventory. One would think that Israel, favored with all these blessings, prepared and educated for centuries for the arrival of its Messiah, would recognize and welcome him when he came. How can one reconcile Israel's privileges with its prejudices? How can one explain Israel's hardening against the gospel? This is the mystery that Paul will next address. God's word has not failed. Romans chapter 9, verses 6 through 13. It is not as though God's word had failed, for not all who are descended from Israel are Israel. nor because they are his descendants are they all Abraham's children. On the contrary, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. In other words, it is not the children by physical descent who are God's children, but it is the children of the promise who are regarded as Abraham's offspring. For this was how the promise was stated: at the appointed time I will return, and Sarah will have a son. Not only that, but Rebekah's children were conceived at the same time by our father Isaac. Yet before the twins were born or had done anything good or bad, in order that God's purpose in election might stand, not by works but by him who calls, she was told, "The older will serve the younger," just as it is written, "Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated." At first sight, it would appear that God's promise to Israel had failed. God had promised to bless them, but they had forfeited his blessing through unbelief. Israel's failure was its own failure, however. It was not due to the failure of God's word. There have always been two Israels, those physically descended from Israel, Jacob, on the one hand, and his spiritual progeny on the other. God's promise was addressed to the latter, who had received it. The apostle has already made this distinction between those who were Jews outwardly, whose circumcision was in the body, and those who were Jews inwardly, who had received a circumcision of the heart by the Spirit. Paul now refers to two well-known Old Testament situations in order to illustrate and prove his point. The first concerns Abraham's family. Just as not all who are descended from Israel are Israel, so not all who are descended from Abraham are Abraham's children, his true offspring. Who can be designated Abraham's offspring? It is not the children by physical descent, but the children of the promise, who were born as a result of God's promise. Paul turns to Isaac and his two sons, Jacob and Esau, for his second illustration. He shows that just as God chose Isaac, not Ishmael, to be the recipient of his promise, so he chose Jacob, not Esau. In this case, it was even clearer that God's decision had nothing to do with any eligibility in the boys themselves, for there was nothing to distinguish them from one another. Isaac and Ishmael had different mothers, but Jacob and Esau had the same mother. In fact, they were twins. Yet, before the twins were born or had done anything good or bad, God had made his decision and revealed it to their mother. The rejected brothers, Ishmael and Esau, were both circumcised, and therefore in some sense they too were members of God's covenant and were both promised lesser blessings. Nevertheless, both stories illustrate the same key truth of God's purpose in election. God's promise did not fail, but it was fulfilled only in the Israel within Israel. Many mysteries surround the doctrine of election, but it is an indispensable foundation of Christian worship in time and eternity. God's redeemed people will spend eternity worshipping him, humbling themselves before him in grateful adoration, ascribing their salvation to him and to the Lamb, and acknowledging that he alone is worthy to receive all praise, honor, and glory. Why? Because our salvation is due entirely to his grace, will, initiative, wisdom, and power. The mercy of God. Romans chapter 9, verses 14 through 18. What then shall we say? Is God unjust? Not at all. For he says to Moses, "I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion." It does not, therefore, depend on human desire or effort, but on God's mercy. For Scripture says to Pharaoh, "I raised you up for this very purpose, that I might display my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth." Therefore God has mercy on whom he wants to have mercy, and he hardens whom he wants to harden. Granted that God's promise has not failed, but has been fulfilled in Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and in their spiritual lineage, is not God's purpose in election intrinsically unjust? Is choosing some for salvation and passing by others a breach of elementary justice? Paul's immediate retort is, not at all. Paul's way of defending God's justice is to proclaim his mercy. It sounds like a complete non sequitur, but it is not. It simply indicates that the question itself is misconceived, because the basis on which God deals savingly with sinners is not justice, but mercy. For salvation does not depend on human desire or effort, that is, on anything we want or strive for, but on God's mercy. Paul sees the divine words to Moses and to Pharaoh, both recorded in Exodus, as complementary. God has mercy on whom he wants to have mercy, the message to Moses, and he hardens whom he wants to harden, the message to Pharaoh. The Exodus account makes it plain that Pharaoh hardened his heart against God and refused to humble himself. God's hardening of him was a judicial act, abandoning him to his own stubbornness. So God is not unjust. As Paul demonstrated in the early chapters of his letter, all human beings are sinful and guilty in God's sight, so that nobody deserves to be saved. If God hardens some, he is not being unjust, for that is what their sin deserves. If, on the other hand, he has compassion on some, he is not being unjust, for he is dealing with them in mercy. The wonder is not that some are saved and others not, but that anybody is saved at all. For we deserve nothing at God's hand but judgment. If we receive what we deserve, judgment, or if we receive what we do not deserve, mercy, in neither case is God unjust. Therefore, if anybody is lost, the blame is theirs, but if anybody is saved, the credit is God's. This paradox contains a mystery our present knowledge cannot solve, but it is consistent with Scripture, history, and experience. God's great patience. Romans chapter 9, verses 19 through 24. One of you will say to me, "Then why does God still blame us? For who is able to resist his will?" But who are you, a human being, to talk back to God? Shall what is formed say to the one who formed it, "Why did you make me like this?" Does not the potter have the right to make out of the same lump of clay some pottery for special purposes and some for common use? What if God, although choosing to show his wrath and make his power known, bore with great patience the objects of his wrath, prepared for destruction? What if he did this to make the riches of his glory known to the objects of his mercy, whom he prepared in advance for glory, even us, whom he also called, not only from the Jews, but also from the Gentiles? Paul's response to his critics' two questions is to pose three counter-questions that all concern our identity. They ask whether we know who we are, what kind of relationship we think exists between us and God, and what attitude to him we consider appropriate to this relationship. All three counter-questions emphasize the yawning gulf between human beings and God. Do we really think it is fitting for a human being to talk back to God? For art to ask the artist why it has been made as it has? Or for a pot to challenge the potter's right to shape the same lump of clay into pottery for different uses? Paul does not wish to stifle genuine questions. After all, he has been asking and answering questions throughout the whole letter. Rather, he censures the person who quarrels with God. Such a person manifests a reprehensible spirit of rebellion, refusing to let God be God, and refusing to acknowledge his or her true status as creature and sinner. But human beings are not merely lumps of inert clay, and this passage well illustrates the danger of arguing from an analogy. To liken humans to pottery is to emphasize the disparity between us and God. But there is another strand in biblical teaching that affirms not our unlikeness, but our likeness to God, because we have been created in his image and because we still bear it, though distorted, even since the fall. As God's image bearers, we are rational, responsible, moral, and spiritual beings, able to converse with God and encouraged to explore his revelation, to ask questions, and to think his thoughts after him. Paul's emphasis here is that as the potter has the right to shape the clay into vessels for different purposes, so God has the right to deal with fallen humanity according to both his wrath and his mercy. The apostle demonstrates that God's freedom to show mercy to some and to harden others is fully compatible with his justice. We must allow God to be God, not only renouncing every presumptuous desire to challenge him, but also assuming that his actions are always in harmony with his nature. The revelation of God's wrath to the objects of his wrath is with a view to the revelation of his glory to the object.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.